When we think about discovering alien life, we have a tendency to see it in terms of finding some planet showing a bio or technosignature. This actually pervades SETI. They are looking star by star, singular targets in hopes of stumbling across something. But there has been more recent thinking that all sky SETI surveys might be more fruitful. You can look at the whole sky for signals instead of only one tiny patch at a time. But it's also possible that there may be a third indicator of alien activity that might offer the best chance at an unambiguous, indisputable detection of an alien civilization. It's clustered planets. We are not yet experts in life, alien life, biospheres, and what possibilities there truly are out there. All we know is what happened here on Earth, and we don't even have a complete picture of that. But what we do have is science, and that gives us many clues, in this case chemistry and physics. You are either allowed to do something in the universe, or you are not. And when astrobiologists look at potentials like liquid water and suspect it may be the main solvent for all life in the universe, is because of how water is. It's abundant, life can thrive in it, and most importantly, the chemical reactions needed for life can happen within it. Not all liquids can fulfill that. Some of them are outright harsh on chemistry, or they are so rare that there just isn't enough of it in the universe to be envisioned as a common solvent. So known science guides our search for alien life, out of the presumption that life elsewhere is beholden to the same rules we are. With that in mind, the biggest problem we face in searching for biosignatures in particular is ambiguity. Many of the gases produced by life are also produced by geology and inanimate circumstances. This has led to much thinking about the potentials for combinations of gas disequilibriums. Let's take those of Earth. Earth's major biosignature is its oxygen. It has a lot of it, and oxygen is highly reactive, which is how oxygen breathers metabolize. But oxygen alone is not necessarily a biosignature. You don't need life for oxygen to be present in an atmosphere. One way this can happen is if oxygen builds up abiotically, when oxygen is released during the breakdown of a molecule. This can happen, especially on planets losing a lot of water. So oxygen alone can be a false positive. What would be helpful is a second gas in disequilibrium, and for Earth, that gas is methane. So taking together Earth's oxygen and methane disequilibriums will make a better case for aliens searching for inhabited worlds that there is life present here. Of course, with Earth, the observing aliens can go much further because at some point they will see industrial chemicals like CFCs, Earth's vegetative red edge in infrared from the plants. They might pick up a radio signal if they're close enough and so on. Building a rock-solid case that there is life and a civilization here, so long as the aliens are close enough for the technosignature. For Earth's biosignature, the entire galaxy knows, because it's been visible for billions of years. So clustering is becoming increasingly important in the search for alien life. We want to see clusters of biosignature gases in odd concentrations to reduce the ambiguity of a single detection of something, but there may be other types of clustering that we might look for regardless of the ambiguity of any individual exoplanet that might be showing something odd, but indeed multiple clustered incidences, which also strongly suggest life. Clustering in planets, like the search for alien life itself, comes in two flavors, panspermia and terraforming. In a paper by Smith and Sinapayan, link in the description below, they explore a model of both and how that might happen. They then looked for correlations and found that if we saw certain things spread across multiple star systems, it would be what they term as an agnostic biosignature. This means that it's independent of most of the assumptions we usually have to make regarding alien life. And assumptions, while necessary, are, after all, assumptions. Here there is a big one. We usually work within the framework of thinking about life in regards to things like its biology, what gases it produces, and so on. But here it's based on something else, how life on interplanetary and interstellar scales acts. The model works like this. They look at a planet that is showing some kind of ambiguous biosignature. Then you cluster them with planets showing similar ambiguous biosignatures. And then you look for patterns and try to determine the spatial extent of the anomalies. So with just life itself transferring through panspermia, usually termed lithopanspermia due to the carrying mechanism being rocks getting blasted off inhabited bodies, you can look at our solar system as an example. So we know Mars rocks have ended up on Earth, blasted off in impacts off the surface of the Red Planet long ago, only to cross interplanetary space to land on Earth. We also know that some Earth life can last an enormously long period of time as a dormant spore. Put the two together and life can transfer in the star system. Panspermia is possible to have happened at Earth, Mars, Venus, the ice shell moons, and so on. That seems like it might be reasonable to expect that to happen elsewhere in the universe much the same. So if you ever see a star system with multiple planets showing ambiguous biospheres, if taken as a whole, you might be able to conclude that life is likely present in that system on several worlds independent of the chemicals involved in the atmospheres of those exoplanets. This would be important in a system like TRAPPIST-1, where you have multiple planets, with three ostensibly within the habitable zone, along with a very high likelihood of rock transfer at some point in the past, due to all those planets orbiting very close to each other very rapidly. If you saw three similar gas disequilibriums in three different worlds in the same system, that would be weird, to say the least, making the case for a biosignature that much better. Looking for terraformers is a technosignature, and very likely a very different type from what we might find using this method with biosignatures. The idea for this has been around for a while, to my knowledge first floated by Robert Zubrin in the 1990s. The idea is that if you see a world in a very weird disequilibrium to the point that the atmosphere looks artificial, or is highly altered by industrial gases, or CFCs, which make for excellent greenhouse gases, if your goal is terraforming cold worlds. If you saw those with one world, it's one thing. But if you saw a cluster of worlds all showing these signs or variations of them, then you've just found a spacefaring, likely extremely ancient, civilization. It's hard to see how there would be any ambiguity in a compounded technosignature of this type, especially if you're really lucky and you have radio transmissions coming from all of them. Even if the terraforming being done is unrecognizable to us and we have no idea what the aliens are doing, it doesn't matter because this framework is agnostic, and all you need is clustered, anomalous strangeness to have a candidate technosignature. Unfortunately, that sort of a situation isn't likely to be discovered or recognized unless by accident, because you're simply not looking for it. A case in point here would be Tabby's star, KIC 8462852. And yes, longtime listeners of the channel will be pleased to know that star's phone number is still burned into my memory. We were lucky to have ever found that one in the Kepler data. What happened is that the data was basically sifted by a computer looking for light curves that looked like dips in light that might signal exoplanet transits in front of their star, and other work done by variable star specialists and stellar flare specialists and so on. And none of those types of light curves looked anything like Tabby's star. So the computers missed it, because they weren't programmed to look for it. That would have been it, except the scientists looking at the Kepler data had enlisted the help of citizen scientists, the planet hunters, who would comb through light curves looking for, again, transits. But they also noticed a small number of light curves, about 10 that I know of, that were just outright strange with no ready explanation. 9 of those are more or less forgotten, but the 10th is still an open question, and it's Tabby's star. But if that chain of events hadn't happened, and computer filtering was used without the planet hunters, we'd have never known about that weird star, which remains a mystery to this day. It's still unclear exactly what's going on there, though we may know more soon, as JWST took a look at it last summer and the results should be published in a paper any day now. But the point is, if you're not looking for it, it comes down to luck as to whether you see it. Indeed, in the mountains of data we've collected over more than a century of modern astronomy, there are many datasets taken for reasons other than looking for aliens that remain to be searched. When the Vera Rubin telescope comes online, very soon in fact, then we will have all sky surveys taken almost every day that will show all sorts of natural phenomena we wouldn't have otherwise seen, including comets, asteroids, minor planets, and so on, but can also be searched for technosignatures as a piggyback by SETI scientists. All of this is leading to shifts in thinking in SETI and answering the "Are we alone?" question. Broader approaches are still being thought of, and there's plenty of room for more. Looking for patterns is a wide open field that not only encompasses looking for cluster technosignatures in space, but also time. You may go centuries without seeing any kind of contact signal, yet one day you begin to get a series of them because, to an alien, constant broadcasting makes no sense, and only periodic broadcasting on whatever timescale they work on seems sensible. Someday we may actually take that approach, should we ever decide to start sending out strong signals with the hope of being intercepted by someone. But until then, we have only ever sent out sporadic signals that no alien could ever verify, according to our rules in SETI. Our biosphere is screaming, but our technosphere really isn't. And what scant little does make it to any real distance has only had just over a century to propagate. That's only about 100 light years. And while there are plenty of stars within that sphere, none of them may have civilizations. And the real fun begins when our signals have had 200, 300, 1,000 years to propagate, or more. But it pays to remember, the Milky Way is large indeed, 100,000 light years across, meaning it may be a very long time indeed before we ever get anyone's attention, and the age of slow communication with an alien species begins. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently overloaded with video topics. There's a lot for the rest of the month, so long as production goes smoothly, gonna be an uptick in activity on this channel for a bit, or else I get buried in scripts. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.